Short notice filling for Chris. So this presentation is on improvement of clinical practice here at Brattleboro Union High School over the last 3 years. So what we're going to cover today, some of the statistics prior to me going through the doctor and the doctoral training program. We're going to also cover the change in some of the principles that the doctor and doctoral training program has instilled in me through the program. And then we're going to go over some case series, case studies, and then do a little bit of comparison of before and after, show the difference and change. So this is pre-DAT injury statistics. So this was first year back here, 2011-2012. So we saw here about 640, give or take, injuries. Then the following year, again, more injuries came in. Saw about 787 injuries over the course of, and this is just high school, so this is not including middle school for what we see from the middle school. So pre-doctor athletic training, the average cost of running the athletic training clinic here was roughly $7,300. And then number of visits per injury per individual, per patient, was about nine or so for ankles and lower legs, 8 for knees, 5 for thighs and pelvis and spine, and then 4 for upper extremities, shoulders, elbows, wrists. And that was a little low just because we didn't really have a whole lot of elbows, shoulders, and wrists. We had a lot of other injuries that we saw over that time period. And these were therapeutic interventions. These would all be daily taping and stretching, and then these would be the therapeutic exercises. These wouldn't just be the times that they just came in and stopped in and said hello. So prior to that doctor of athletic training, some of my philosophies were, for as far as rehabilitation was, is to strengthen any of the joints, improve their flexibility, and improve balance. Ice was pretty much required for anybody that was injured. Especially for up to 48 hours for acute care. And chronic pain also required cryotherapy to decrease any kind of pain stimulus that was coming from their injuries. And then my treatment toolbox was pretty simplistic, just because some of the caseload that we have here and the ages, some things are limited that we can do for that age. But we'd use TheraBands, we'd use strengthening exercises, electrical stimulation devices, stretching, and then taping or strapping. So entering the doctor of athletic training, their principle is to take a holistic approach and correct any kind of dysfunctions throughout the body, because their belief is a dysfunction in that a shoulder can actually cause an issue in the ankle. And this is done by treating and evaluating the physical, the chemical, and emotional natures of causations of pain and dysfunctions throughout the body. And to also back up any kind of findings that we have through action research, outcome collections that are like those score sheets and things like that that we get pre and post interventions, and blogs to share with information that we collect and find as we go along through our daily clinical practice with other healthcare professionals and with fellow DAT faculty and students. So now the toolbox is much more full of what I can offer now. Positional release therapy, Mulligan concept, primal reflex release technique, craniosacral energy techniques, total motion release, scraping or instrument-assisted massage, which I focus more on Hua Sha, which is a Chinese version. Tapping, localized therapy, trauma-reducing exercises, and then we can also do other total body evaluations such as the selective SFMA, the selective functional movement assessment.
Can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
The Mulligan concept, what is that?
So that is a joint repositioning. So that's where you use a certain movement that's being painful, and then doing a slight little joint manipulation, and then running them through that movement again. So if the joint is out of alignment, and you put it back in alignment, it'll make a pain-free movement that was just pain-free or painful, and then you use that movement to rehouse that that joint again.
Okay. And the soft tissue massage is based on the blood flow in the fascia, is that?
Yes.
Yep. Most of that?
Yep. Okay. So current philosophies since joining the DAT, as far as rehabilitation, no longer using the clinic as a healthcare fast food is the way I describe it as trying to be as fast as I possibly can and seeing 45 individuals with barely minimum standard of care. Mm-hmm. And focusing more on actually correcting an issue, whether it takes me my normal 45 minutes for an evaluation and treatment. Treating the root cause of pain, so whether it's local at a knee, if that's where the case is, or if the case for the knee is actually in the shoulder, treating the shoulder and global, or anything like that, that's where I would be working on that as well. Mm-hmm. And just let the patient's body be my guide. Many patients' bodies will allow me to focus in with where the dysfunctions are, and many times the body will actually tell me what needs to be done, by whether it's the tensions in the fascia or dysfunctional movement in another part of the body. Many times it's actually the body tells you what it wants and it's very clear. As far as teaching individuals, expanding students, patients, and other healthcare providers' thoughts on patient care. So moving away from the more traditional, if it's at this location, it has to be caused by that location. And broadening other people's thoughts that it can be caused by another location altogether that you wouldn't necessarily think. Treating all experiences with the student athletes here as a teaching moment. Every day you come in, whether I think I've seen this before or not, many times it's a little different because everybody's patient's history is a little different. So there's always a little tweak in it that makes it a little bit more interesting every day. And all healing is participatory, not just by me, but also by the patient as well. And making them be a part of it, whether it's decision-making, that they want to use this fascia treatment or if they want to use these type of means, they're allowed to make decisions of what they feel is the correct thing that they need to do. And then scholarly practice. I really like this quote that we started from way back in the first year, never stepping into the same stream twice. That, again, if you think you've seen something before, it's not always necessarily that case. It very much can be something that it just looks it, and it's actually going to develop into something else as you follow it along.
Fresh eyes.
Yep. Keeping an open and mindful reasoning that, if anything, and be open to things that, whether I think it's this, but somebody else finds something different, and that way, and I'm open to that concept, because that my way may be good, but their way may be actually better, and vice versa.
Yeah.
Challenging preconceived notions of healing time frames. We'll go into that a little later on, but if somebody tells you that an ankle is going to take two to four weeks to heal, I would like to try and challenge that and try and make somebody within a couple days and get you back to what they want to do, mm-hmm. being pain-free. And then searching out new knowledge and providing the best care, whether that's reading manuscripts and research from other individuals, or digesting information that I collect throughout the day, the weeks, the months, the years, and treating individuals and trying to find what's the best care, what can most people benefit from. I see something. So now this is an injury comparison from the last 5 years. So we got the first 2 years, so 643 and 787, and then, is that just me?
Yes. Mark for it.
So 2013-2014 was my first year in the doctorate program. We were able to reduce injuries all the way down to 302 treated. 2014-2015, we were able to decrease it even a little bit more, down to 293. And then this year, we're up a little bit, 331 so far. We've had a rough spring. We've had a lot of injuries this spring.
I see.
But still, drastically lower by taking this more holistic approach and reducing the amount of time it takes.
Over 50%.
So now searching for answers. I mean, it's good that they teach us all these things, but now we've got to go out and search these answers for what we have here, because every client's different. So now we're going to some case theories. We're going a little bit into So the dragon technique. So this is for nosebleeds. So the dragon technique is very, very interesting. So the average time that most medical areas, Johns Hopkins, Mayo Clinic, and Cleveland Clinic, which are some of the larger clinics in the country, they all state on their web pages that it takes 5 to 10 minutes, but traditional means to stop a nosebleed. So that's their traditional mean is by holding, pinching the nose, putting the head in a flush position, and then sometimes some say put ice in the neck, some say put ice right here. There's a little bit of differentials how they all present, but they're all saying it takes 5 to 10 minutes to stop a nosebleed. However, I found that this dragon technique takes less than 5 seconds. And this can go from just a little drip of the nosebleed to a full-on hemorrhage, where the blood is just going everywhere.
Yeah.
And it's effective 98% of the time so far. The only patient I have to say that it didn't work on, it actually worked a little too well. It stopped it, but I had a nasal sponge in his nose, and then the clot got stuck on the sponge when I took it out, and then it restarted. And then we did it again, did the same thing, pulled the clot again. So I technically have to say it's a fail, but it almost worked a little too well on that poor guy. So then I've actually modified it here. So the traditional method of this dragging technique is a person lays down on their back, and then they flex their hip to 90 degrees, and then they bring their toes up towards them as high as they can on the side that they're bleeding, so we'll say the right side. So I lift my right leg up while I'm laying on my back, and then somebody hits my heel 3 times, really hard, and then that would stop. And then what I found is that you can actually do it to yourself. You can actually do this very same technique to yourself, and I don't have to touch you at all. And all the difference is that you can stand up and bring your toes up towards you, and then you stomp your heel 3 times and start again. And it has the same effect. And many patients are actually doing it in their cars. They have a nosebleed in their cars, which luckily they stop first, not hit the gas. But we've had people over the phone, I've had people over at the career center, I've had people all over, and it seems to work every single time.
She raises your leg up on the side of the bleed.
So the toe up on the side that you're bleeding on, and then hit it 3 times.
Okay.
And then pathologically, I don't know how it works. And brought it up in the doctor program as far as doesn't really make a whole lot of sense, and we're still trying to work on it and figure out what it is, but it seems to work so far.
Wow. Okay.
So now shin splints, which has been a really big one this year. So for this year, in the first year of the doctor program, all the information that I found about shin splints is actually stemmed from this one patient all the way back in 2013, who was a soccer player. And she'd been complaining of shin pain in both her legs for over 6 years with no resolution. And it only happened in soccer, which was really kind of another strange thing. But over time, what we found is that there was a rib restriction and fascial tissue in her neck that led to dysfunctional breathing, that led to a fascial restriction right here in her hip that pulled too much on the fascia and caused both sides shin pain. And as we and then we released it and made things much better. But it took a long time, and it took an entire soccer season. We made her better every single time she came in.
Yeah.
But I never really found that total thing for her. It wasn't until this fall where we started to see some shin splints, some MTSS patients come in, and we're actually to where I actually was able to find it again, because it took 2 years because we didn't have any other patients that presented that. So this is actually the pathway of this fascia, and I'm calling it essentially it's a deep spire, because that's what it actually looks like. It starts here, and then it rotates around the body and spirals down all the way down into the lower leg. So, treatment-wise, so we do the primal release, which is I flick their elbows, and it causes this little oscillation to that area, and it causes the scalene, the one in the neck, to essentially relax. And then combining that with PRT down here on the inside of the shin, and then doing a few corrective breathing exercises, and we get some great results.